This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: How Theosophy Came to Me. Charles Webster Leadbeater. Year: 1930. Chapter 1. In Ancient Greece. My first touch with anything that could definitely be called theosophy was in the year 504 BC, when I had the wonderful honor and pleasure of visiting the great philosopher Pythagoras. I had taken birth in one of the families of the Eupatridae at Athens, a family in fairly good circumstances and offering favorable opportunities for progress. This visit was the most important event in my youth, and it came about in this manner. A relation of mine offered to take me, along with a brother a year or two younger, for a voyage in a ship of which he was part owner. It was a trading voyage among the Greek islands and over to the Asiatic shore, and with the leisurely methods of those days it occupied nearly a year, during which we visited many places and saw not only much beautiful scenery, but many marvelous temples adorned with exquisite sculpture. Among other islands we called at Samos, and it was there that we found the great Pythagoras, who was then a man of advanced age and very near his death. Some historians have thought that this sage perished when his school at Crotona was wrecked by popular prejudice. Others, recognizing that he survived that catastrophe, believe that he died much later at Metapontum. Neither of these ideas seems to be correct. When very old, he left his schools in Magna Graecia and returned to his patrimony in Samos to end his days where he had begun them, and so it happened that we had this very great privilege of seeing him in the course of our voyage. His principal disciple at that time was Cleinias, now the master Dijwal Kul. And Cleinias was exceedingly kind to us, and patiently answered all our eager questions, explaining to us the system of the Pythagorean philosophy. We were at once most strongly attracted towards the teaching expounded to us, and were anxious to join the school. Cleinias told us that a branch of it would presently be opened in Athens, and meantime he gave us much instruction in ethics, in the doctrine of reincarnation, and the mystery of numbers. All too soon our vessel was ready for sea. It had fortunately required refitting, and we had regretfully to take leave of Pythagoras and Cleinias. To our great and awed delight, when we called to bid him adieu, the aged philosopher blessed us and said with marked emphasis, "Palin synantisomatha, we shall meet again." Within a year or two we heard of his death, and so we often wondered in what sense he could have meant those words. But when in this present incarnation I had for the first time the privilege of meeting the Master Kuthumi, he recalled to my memory that scene of long ago, and said, "Did I not tell you that we should meet again?" Soon after the death of Pythagoras, Cleinias fulfilled his promise to come and establish a school of the philosophy in Athens, and naturally my brother and I were among his first pupils. Large numbers were attracted by his teaching, and the philosophy took a very high place in the thought of the time. Except for what was actually necessary for the management of the family estate, I devoted practically the whole of my time to the study and teaching of this philosophy, and indeed succeeded to the position of Cleinias when he passed away. My early attitude. It may have been owing to this exclusive devotion to this higher thought that I had a very unusually long period in the heaven world, just over 2,300 years. To what extent that fact affected my present life, I cannot say, but I arrived in this incarnation without any definite memory of all that I had learnt at the cost of so much time and trouble. In my early life I knew nothing whatever of these matters, but in looking back now upon that period, I can see that I found myself in possession of a set of convictions which I had evidently brought over from that other life. The middle of last century was a time of widespread materialism, of disbelief or at least uncertainty as to religious matters, and scornful denial of the possibility of any kind of non-physical manifestation. Even as a child I was aware that men were arguing hotly as to the existence of God and the possibility that there might be something in man which survives death. But when I heard such discussions, I wondered silently how people could be so foolish, for I myself had an unshakable interior certainty on these points, though I could not argue in defense of my belief or indeed bring forth any reason to support it. But I knew that there was a God, that He was good, and that death was not the end of life. Even at that age, I was able to deduce from these certainties that all must somehow be well, although so often things appeared to be going ill. I remember well how horrified I was, and I am afraid very angry as well, when a small playfellow introduced to my notice the theory of hell. I promptly contradicted him, but he insisted that it must be true because his father had said so. I went home in great indignation to consult my own father on this incredible abomination, but he only smiled tolerantly and said, "Well, my boy, I don't for a moment believe it myself, but a great many people think so, and it is no use trying to convince them, you will just have to put up with it." So by degrees I learnt that one's own interior conviction, however strong, was ineffective as an argument against orthodox opinion. One other curious little fragment of half-recollection I seem to have brought over from that Greek incarnation. As a child, I used frequently to dream of a certain house, quite unlike any with which I was at that time familiar on the physical plane, for it was built round a central courtyard, with fountains and statues and shrubs, into which all the rooms looked. I used to dream of this perhaps 3 times a week, and I knew every room of it, and all the people who lived in it. I used constantly to describe it to my mother and to make ground plans of it. We called it my dream house. As I grew older, I dreamt of it less and less frequently, until at last it faded from my memory altogether. But one day, much later in life, to illustrate some point, my master showed me a picture of the house in which I had lived in my last incarnation, and I recognized it immediately. Although, as I have already said, I had the most absolute interior conviction with regard to the life after death, I soon came to recognize that in discussing the matter with others, it would be an immense advantage to have something of the nature of physical plane evidence to produce. It occurred to me that such evidence ought to be discoverable if one were disposed to give a certain amount of time and trouble to searching for it. I remembered when I was quite a boy coming across a copy of Mrs. Crowe's Night Side of Nature, which I read with the greatest interest, and it seemed to me that if I could have the opportunity of investigating at first hand cases similar to those which she described, I should surely in process of time be able to arrive at something definite which I could quote in answer to inquiries. Personal investigations. Occasionally, there would appear in some newspaper an account of the appearance of a ghost or of curious happenings in a haunted house. And whenever anything of that sort came to my notice, I promptly traveled down to the scene of action, interrogated any witnesses that I could find, and spent a good deal of time and trouble in endeavoring personally to encounter the spectral visitant. Of course, in a large number of instances, I drew a blank. Either there was no evidence worth mentioning, or the ghost declined to appear when he was wanted. Even when there was a witness to be found, who had a reasonably credible story to tell, it seemed that the ghost did not stay long enough to say or do anything of special interest, or, perhaps, it was the witness who did not stay long enough. Still, among the wearisome monotony of many failures, there came sometimes a bright oasis of definite success, and I presently collected an amount of direct evidence which would have absolutely convinced me if I had needed convincing. At the same time, I also investigated a number of cases of what is called second sight, chiefly in the Highlands, and there again I found that it was easy for any unprejudiced person who was willing to take a little trouble to satisfy himself as to the genuineness of the phenomena. Spiritualism. Unfortunately, I was at that time quite ignorant that there was another line of possible inquiry, that of spiritualism. The first time that, so far as I can recollect, I ever heard of such a thing was in connection with the séances held by Mr. D.D. Home with the Emperor Napoleon III. A series of articles describing them was written by the Reverend Maurice Davies in the Daily Telegraph, but the statements which he made seemed to me at that time quite incredible, and when reading one of the articles aloud to my mother one evening, I expressed strong doubts as to whether the description could possibly be accurate. The article ended, however, with the remark that anyone who felt unable to credit the story might readily convince himself of its possibility by bringing together a few of his friends and inducing them to sit quietly round a small table, either in darkness or in dim light, with the palms of their hands resting lightly upon the surface of the table. It was stated that a still easier plan was to place an ordinary silk hat upon the table, brim upwards, and let two or three people rest their hands lightly upon the brim. It was asserted that the hat or table would presently begin to turn, and in this way, the existence of a force not under the control of anyone present would be demonstrated. This sounded fairly simple, and my mother suggested that as it was just growing dusk and the time seemed appropriate, we should make the experiment forthwith. Accordingly, I took a small round table with a central leg, the normal vocation of which was to support a flower pot containing a great arum lily. I brought in my own silk hat from the stand in the hall, and placed it on the table, and we put our hands upon its brim as prescribed. The only person present besides my mother and myself was a small boy of 12, who, as we afterwards discovered, was a powerful physical medium, but I knew nothing about mediums then. I do not think that any of us expected any result whatever, and I know that I was immensely surprised when the hat gave a gentle but decided half-turn on the polished surface of the table. Each of us thought the other must have moved it unconsciously, but it soon settled that question for us, for it twirled and gyrated so vigorously that it was difficult for us to keep our hands upon it. At my suggestion, we raised our hands, the hat came up under them, as though attached to them, and remained suspended a couple of inches from the table for a few moments before falling back upon it. This new development astonished me still more, and I endeavored to obtain the same result again. For a few minutes the hat declined to respond, but when at last it did come up as before, it brought the table with it. Here was my own familiar silk hat, which I had never before suspected of any occult qualities, suspending itself mysteriously in the air from the tips of our fingers, and not content with that defiance of the laws of gravity on its own account, attaching a table to its crown and lifting that also. I looked down to the feet of the table. They were about 6 inches from the carpet, and no human foot was touching them or near them. I passed my own foot underneath, but there was certainly nothing there, nothing physically perceptible at any rate. Of course, when the hat first moved, it had crossed my mind that the small boy must somehow be playing a trick upon us, but in the first place he obviously was not doing so, and in the second he could not possibly have produced this result unobserved. After about 2 minutes, the table dropped away from the hat, and almost immediately the latter fell back to its companion, but the experiment was repeated several times at intervals of a few minutes. Then the table began to rock violently, and threw the hat off, a plain hint to us if any of us had known enough to take it. But none of us had any idea of what to do next, though we were keenly interested in these extraordinary movements. I was not myself thinking of the phenomenon in the least as a manifestation from the dead, but only as the discovery of some strange new force. This rather frivolous beginning led me to make further inquiries, and I soon found that there was a considerable literature devoted to this subject, and that I might carry my investigations much further by seances with regular mediums. Of course, I encountered a certain amount of fraud, and still more stupidity, but I was presently able to satisfy myself beyond all doubt that some at least of the manifestations were due to the action of those whom we call the dead. There is practically a whole phenomenon of which I read in spiritualistic books, or hear in spiritualistic circles, which I have not myself witnessed under definite test conditions. Any reader who wishes for a fuller account of my investigations and their result will find it in my book, The Other Side of Death, or in that small part of the same book which is published separately under the title of Spiritualism and Theosophy. I have related in considerable detail some of these events of my early life, in order to make clear to my readers the attitude of mind in which I was when Theosophy eventually came before me, which I think explains the way in which I instantaneously reacted to it. I ought perhaps just to mention one other incident of my pre-Theosophy life, which, insignificant though it was in itself, predisposed me to the acceptance of much that I might otherwise have doubted. A story of Madame Blavatsky. The very first news that I ever heard of our great founder, Madame Blavatsky, was curious and characteristic, and the hearing of it was a most important event in my life, though I did not know it then. A staunch friend of my school days took up the sea life as his profession, and about the year 1879, he was second officer on board one of the coasting vessels of the British India Steam Navigation Co. On her voyage from Bombay to Colombo, Madame Blavatsky happened to travel by that steamer, and thus my friend was brought into contact with that marvelous personality. He told me two very curious stories about her. It seems that one evening he was on the bridge trying vainly to light a pipe in a high wind. Being on duty, he could not leave the bridge, so he struck match after match only to see the flame instantly extinguished by the gale. Finally, with an expression of impatience, he abandoned the attempt. As he straightened himself, he saw just below him a dark form closely wrapped in a cloak, and Madame Blavatsky's clear voice called to him. "Cannot you light it then?" "No," he replied. "I do not believe that anyone could keep a match alight in such a wind as this." "Try once more," said Madame Blavatsky. He laughed, but he struck another match, and he assures me that in the midst of that gale and quite unprotected from it, that match burnt with a steady flame clear down to the fingers that held it. He was so astounded that he quite forgot to light his pipe after all, but HPB only laughed and turned away. On another occasion during the voyage, the first officer made in Madame Blavatsky's presence some casual reference to what he would do on the return voyage from Calcutta. The steamers used to go round the coast from Bombay to Calcutta and back again. She interrupted him, saying, "No, you will not do that, for you will not make the return voyage at all. When you reach Calcutta, you will be appointed captain of another steamer, and you will go in quite a different direction." "Madame," said the first officer, "I wish with all my heart you might be right, but it is impossible. It is true I hold a master's certificate, but there are many before me on the list for promotion. Besides, I have signed an agreement to serve on the coasting run for 5 years." "All that does not matter," replied Madame Blavatsky. "You will find it will happen as I tell you." And it did, for when that steamer reached Calcutta, it was found that an unexpected vacancy had occurred, I think through the sudden death of a captain, and there was no one at hand who could fill it but that same first officer. So the prophecy which had seemed so impossible.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.